had to switch mics because this holder wouldn't fit the big mic.
Yep.
So you just have to readjust your height on here.
Good morning, Trail Alliance Church. Thank you all so much for joining us to worship this morning. We have a fantastic morning ahead of us, worshiping God and just coming together as a family, celebrating, right? Celebrating His resurrection, celebrating His goodness, and you know what? Just celebrating the fact that He has made us a family. Right, He has brought us together. He has united us, and we are just so blessed to have one another. As part of that celebration, we like to get together. We like to have fun. We like to, be a family. And so our Young at Heart got together. Was it last weekend? The Young at Heart got together. They had a wonderful time of fellowship. They did some crafts. And we have a little video Jenny prepared for us, showing us what went on last weekend. So, we have a really big weekend coming up next weekend. Really big weekend coming up next weekend. Two huge things are happening. Number one, the youth, the senior youth, grade 10, 11, and 12, we are going to Saskatchewan. It's not something you cheer about. We are going to Saskatchewan. Next weekend is Youthquake, huge youth convention at Briarcrest Bible College. It is going to be wonderful. We're leaving Thursday at noon, driving to Lethbridge, staying at the Alliance Church there, continuing on Friday. It's going to be so good. But can I please, please, please ask you guys to be praying for our youth, right? If you were at our fundraiser a couple months ago, right? I mean, I shared my testimony, I shared my story. Youthquake changed my life, right? Youthquake is where I went from genuinely a bad kid, right? 4 months before Youthquake, I was arrested for B&E and theft. 4 months after Youthquake, I was a junior counselor at Pines Bible Camp, right? God completely turned my life around at this weekend. And I'm praying that for our kids, not that anybody would get arrested in the next couple of days. But that it would just be a life-changing experience for them. Please be praying for our youth next weekend and this week leading up to it. Also, next weekend, for those of you who can't come, we've got some fun here for you guys as well. Next Saturday, 9 till noon, is our spring cleanup here at the church. Okay? And something I learned when I was living in Saskatchewan. Okay, you want to talk about joy. You want to talk about fun. Mm-hmm. What you do, what you're doing is so much less important than who you're doing it with. Right? I would rather be sweeping the parking lot and digging up weeds with a couple of friends than playing hockey with a couple of jerks. Right? Like, I'm going to have so much more fun doing the one than the other, right? This is a time for us, again, just to come together as a family, spend the morning together, do some good. Lunch will be provided 9 till noon next Saturday. And then the weekend after that, May 7th, Mark Peters, our district superintendent, will be here. I believe he's going to be leading the service and then having a meeting. There will be a meeting after the service as well, kind of a Q&A session, just talking about the Alliance, Alliance DNA, and other things, right? It's also a Q&A, so bring them your questions. And that's next Sunday, May 7th. Beauty. Now I would like to invite the worship team up, and Bob has a special announcement as well.
Must have missed that last little bit, but okay, yeah. Good morning, everybody. So a couple of announcements just before that we get started, kind of from the elders, from the board of elders. So I know that we have been trying to improve our communication, and maybe I haven't been we haven't been up here sharing as much as we could be, and still working on that to kind of keep you posted on what's going on in our church. So Pastor Carl's going to give an update for the transitional committee and search committee just before his talk, but also just some things that I wanted to point out. So at our last AGM, we elected some new elders, and Brian used to be our board chair. He was now off because he had served two terms. So I was elected to be the new board chair, but also just like on the back of your bulletin, it says who all the elders are and what their positions are. So like myself, I'm the chair and secretary, Dean Johnson, vice chair in charge of ministry missions, Joe Vanderham is our treasurer, John Severin, Family Ministries and Benevolent, and then Shane Hoffsing for Building Maintenance. So if you ever have questions about the church or what we're doing, feel free to bring that up to us. And another one that I wanted to just highlight to you too was that there was a new music committee that was formed. So this music committee is myself, Richard Davis, Dennis Elhard, and Joanne Vanderham. And the reason why we created this was there was some people that had come to the elders and to people on the music team, just who had some concerns over the music that was played. And so we had met together as a group. We kind of created this committee. And after some discussions, we realized that there are some sources of music, whether it's like groups or writers who have some questionable theology, or it could even be like reaching towards heretical. So we want to, how do we distinguish what music we want to play, which music we aren't? So we made a committee, and what we decided on doing is that we would not be making a blanket statement saying like, oh, we're just not going to play something from Bethel or something like that, or there's other ones that may just be maybe some people have some concerns with, rather, because it's tough to where do you draw the line for that music, because there's so many different songwriters who maybe have good music, or what did they do in the past, how did they change. So we said we would not do that, but rather we're going to go through as a committee and just have kind of an approved list to make sure that it's worshiping God, and that it's God honoring and true to His word. So that's what we're doing. So if you have any concerns about music, feel free to come to myself, Dennis, Richard, and Joanne. Yeah, okay, that was it. And I also have the privilege of leading worship today too. It's been a while since I've been up here, so I'm excited that I get to be here. It's just another great day to worship our Lord and to celebrate a baptism. So please stand and worship with us. Yeah, so let us begin with our call to worship. Church family, let us lift our voices in praise of God who has saved us from all our sins and brought us from death to life.
Praise is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. And His greatness is unsearchable.
One generation shall commend your works to another, and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty, and on your wondrous works I will meditate.
They shall speak of the might of your awesome deeds, and I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness, and shall sing aloud of your righteousness.
The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and His mercy is over all that He has made.
All your worship shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known the children of many your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom.
Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom,
and your dominion endures throughout all generations.
Amen. Let's sing together.
We need some help with the first word. It's very difficult. Can you put it up there, Trev?
Okay,
so that's,
here we go. Ready?
When you found me, I was so blind. My sin was before me, I was swallowed by pride. But out of the darkness you brought me to your light. You showed me new mercies and opened up my eyes. From the day you saved my soul till the very moment when I come home, I'll sing, I'll dance, my heart will overflow. From the day you saved my soul, is all around. An endless joy is the only sound. Oh, rest my heart forever now. Oh, in your arms all till the very moment when I come home, I'll sing, I'll dance, my heart will overflow. save my soul. Till the very moment when I come home, I'll sing, I'll dance, my heart will overflow. From the day you saved my soul, from the day you saved my soul, till the very moment when I come home, I'll sing, I'll dance, my heart will overflow. From the day you saved my soul.
Amen. It's a good day. It's always fun to be celebrating baptisms, looking forward to that when people declare that, yes, I am a Christian and I believe in our Lord Jesus Christ.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Okay, this next one will be... It's a kid's song. So down in Sunday school, today they're learning about Jesus and his followers. And so this is a time in Jesus' ministry where there were lots of people starting to follow Jesus, and he wanted to make sure that they knew that he wanted to tell them that sometimes following me, I'm going to ask a lot of you. I'm going to give you, there's lots of rewards that come from following me, but it's also not always going to be easy. So Jesus says in Luke chapter 9, verse 23, if you want to follow me, you must deny yourself and follow me. So we're going to do it slow a couple times so you can get the feel of it, and then the third time we'll do it kind of normal speed, but you got to say follow, follow, follow really fast. Follow, 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 follow. Okay?
If anyone would come, come after me. If anyone would come, come after me. He must deny himself and take his cross up daily and follow, 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 follow me. That's Luke chapter 9, verse 23.
There you go. We'll do it again.
If anyone would come, come after me. If anyone would come, come after me. He must deny himself and take his cross up daily and follow, 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 follow me.
That's Luke chapter 9, verse 23. Okay, we're going to pick it up a little bit. If anyone would come after me, woo-hoo. If anyone would come after me, hi-hi. He must deny himself and take his cross up daily and follow me. Follow again. And follow me. That's Luke chapter 9, verse 23. All right.
Good job, everyone.
Now, why don't you, while we're all standing, take a moment to just greet one another and say good morning. Thanks, everybody. So as I had mentioned earlier, we do have a baptism this morning. So if you can come back to your seats, and I'll get Trevor to cue up. So Anna Kopp, she's been in this church for a number of years now. She's getting baptized, and she has her testimony just on a video. So we're going to hear that and see that now.
Hello, my name is Anna Kopp, and I'm going to be sharing my testimony with you. All my life, I've known about God, Jesus, and creation. I've gone to church and read my Bible, but just in these past few years, it's been different. I still know and do these things, but with my own faith. What I mean is, all those years I believed wasn't because of me. If I wouldn't have grown up in a Christian home, I don't know what I'd believe. It was like I had my mom's faith and not my own. Before my dad was a Christian, it was really hard. Other idols in our life took away our time, and we missed church a lot. We weren't strong in our faith, but when my dad became a Christian, after years of praying for him, my faith was encouraged by the amazing prayer that had been answered. It made me realize that God actually loved me and listened to my prayers. He loved me so much that he gave his only son to die as a sacrifice for our sins. Even though I was completely unworthy, he saved me. I want to be baptized because I want to publicly declare that Jesus is my Lord and Savior. In Acts 22:16, it says, "And now, what are you waiting for? Get up and be baptized and wash your sins away, calling on his name. This is what I want to do. I'm a new creation of Jesus Christ."
Anna.
Hello.
Anna, we are so happy for you and proud of you. We love to see you desiring to commit to Jesus and know him more. We love that you're wanting to share with us and your church family and the world that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. We look forward to, with great excitement, seeing what God has planned for your future and your life. We just advise you to love Jesus with your whole heart, your whole soul, your whole mind. And there's two verses we would like to share with you this morning. First is Titus 3, verses 4 to 7. "But when the kindness and love of God, our Savior, appeared, he saved us, not because of the righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy." And Psalms 34, 5. "Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame." Love you.
All right, Anna, I'm just going to ask you a couple questions here. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is God Almighty, who came down as a man, lived a perfect life, died on the cross for your sins, and on the third day rose again and is alive in heaven today?
I do.
Have you, through repentance towards God and faith in Jesus Christ, experienced the forgiveness of your sins?
I have.
Do you renounce the world and all its temporal pleasures, choosing instead to focus your eyes on heaven and the treasure that awaits you there?
I do.
Do you renounce the works of the devil and the authority of all spiritual powers, save God alone?
I do.
Anna Kopp, who is the Lord of your life?
Jesus Christ.
Based on your confession of faith before all those gathered here, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. I'll now invite the kids to come up, and we'll just pray for you guys before you guys go downstairs.
Okay. It's good to see you all this morning. I'll pray for us and then we'll head downstairs, okay? Precious Jesus, thank you that you have called us to follow you. And God, in the Bible, in the book of Luke, chapter 9, verse 23, like we read in, or sang in our kids' song, you told us that following you wouldn't always be easy, that there would be tough times. Thank you, God, that though it can be tough, following you is always worth it. And thank you that you give us your Spirit to help us through. Please help us as we learn this morning. Help us to praise you and help us to know you and to love you. Amen.
And as the kids are making it down, we'll just have a time of corporate prayer, and also after that we'll have our we'll give our tithes and offerings. So the ushers after the prayers, if you can be come for that, please pray with me. Heavenly Father, as the psalmist proclaims, how lovely, O God, is your dwelling place. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Our souls yearn for you, and may our hearts and flesh cry out for the living God. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you, and blessed are those whose strength is in you. Lord, I pray for our church. I thank you, Lord, for the work of the transition team has done over these past number of months, and as they move into the role of the search committee, I pray that you'd give them wisdom and discernment. We also pray, Lord, for the new lead pastor that will be coming to this church. Whoever they will be, Lord, we pray that they would be a godly man and eager to serve you, that he would teach faithfully and teach your word well. By faith, we trust that you will bring us the right pastor at the right time for us, and we pray that you'd give us patience and wisdom as we look. Lord, we also pray for protection and healing for those who are sick and recovering, as well as those who are grieving and mourning. We pray for continued healing for Sherry, and as well as those who we name in our hearts. Lord, I pray for the elders. I pray that you would help us to lead well and to make decisions that are honoring to you, that we'd be quick to listen and humble in our role. We pray for all the small groups are meeting. Lord, we pray that you would bless their time together and that you would encourage fellowship and the building of relationships with one another. We pray, Lord, for international workers and all the workers and laborers who are spreading your gospel to others. We thank you, Lord, for the missions committee and the places that we've heard about, like Danny shared last week, about how the gospel is spreading in Iran, and we just pray for your continued, for just the global universal church, that your name would be proclaimed. I pray for the children and kids' church as they go downstairs, that this would be a time where they are learning about you and building a foundation about knowledge of you and a love for you. Lord, I pray for the youth. I pray for the upcoming trip that they're going to Youthquake and all the leaders that are going there. For all the youth that are going there, may this be a time that they would be hearing about you, that you would be that there would be a fire burning within their hearts, and that they'd be seeking you, and that this would be a life-changing decision for you. We pray for safety for them as they go, and that it would be an encouraging time for them. I also thank you, Lord, for Anna and the baptism that we saw. We thank you, Lord, and we celebrate that the just people proclaiming their love of you and that you are the Lord and Savior of their life, and we thank you for that. We pray for your protection over her and that you'd protect her from temptation and from the evil one, Lord. We pray for all of our young families, young adults as well, Lord. We pray that you'd be working in marriages, that marriages would be focused on you and be united in loving you and having a common purpose, that we would put aside our selfish desires, Lord, and put away our pride, and that we would be desiring to know you and to honor you. I pray, Lord, for the Young at Heart group and those who are no longer working. Lord, may they be having fellowship with one another and having a desire to live a life serving you. I also pray for those who are watching the service who aren't able to be here with us in person. I pray that you would bless them and fill them with joy, knowing that they are still a part of the body of Christ. We pray, Lord, for the tithes and offerings that will be about to be received. May our giving be a sign of worship to you, and may these funds be used to give you glory. And we also pray for Pastor Carl and the message that we'll hear today. Please prepare our hearts for the message that you would have us hear, and may you speak with the Holy Spirit through him. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Betty Ann. I'll invite the worship team to come back up, and we'll sing a couple more songs. So I asked Anna. I said I told her last week I'm leading worship, and I know that you're getting baptized. Do you have any special requests? So this is one for Anna. Please rise as we continue to worship our God.
Praise the Lord, His mercy is more, stronger than darkness. New every morn, our sins they are many, His mercy is more. What love could remember, no wrongs we have done, omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore, our sins they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, anew every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What patience would wait as we constantly roam? What Father so tender is calling us home? He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord. sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What riches of kindness He lavished on us. His blood was a payment, His life was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more.
This next song is taken from Psalm 84, so I'll just read a few verses. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts! My soul longs, yes, faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and flesh sing for joy to the living God, for one day in your courts is better than a thousand elsewhere.
How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty. My soul doth longs and even faints for you. For here my heart is satisfied within your presence. I sing beneath the shadow of your wings. And better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts, thousands elsewhere, thousands elsewhere. One thing I ask, and I would seek, to see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells. One thing I ask, and I would seek, to seek your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. My heart and flesh cry out to you, a living God, till spirits water to my soul. soul. I've tasted and I've seen, come once again to me. I will draw near to you, I will draw near to you. And better is one day, better is one day, better is one day than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day, better is one day, better is one day than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your coast, better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your course than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your course. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your course than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere, than a thousand elsewhere.
We come to seek you and love you. Pray this in your name. Amen. Please have a seat as we call Pastor Carl up to give us our message.
Worship team. Wonderful songs, wonderful baptism. See people come to that place in their faith where they want to take that extra step, where they want to draw closer to God. It's absolutely wonderful. As Bob has said, I want to give you as a church a little bit of an update. Over the past 5 months, I've been working together with our transitional team. And over those 5 months, we have looked at some of Trail Alliance's church history. We have looked at what the church is today. In other words, discovering who we are as Trail Alliance today. Looking at our community and surrounding areas and understanding our community a little bit better. We have looked at Trail Alliance's strengths, weaknesses, its opportunities, its threats. We have looked at struggles and needs and changes, not only in our community, but also with who we are as a church. We've gone through a process of understanding the heart of worship through worship itself, which was not just a time of gathering to worship, but our lives being a worship to God, looking at fellowship, looking at discipleship and outreach. You have also participated as a church, or given the opportunity to participate in our church health and vision assessment questionnaire, and many of you did respond, and we got your responses back. We've had an opportunity to look and do an analysis of those results, and through those results, we have been working to put together and are in the process of putting together a report to give you an understanding of not only what we've gone through, but where our church is, where the church is going, what we need as a church, and looking forward to inviting a new pastor to come to lead your church for many years. And so Going through this process also marks a change for our transitional team. That report we plan to share with you within the next couple of weeks. But at the same time, we're also transitioning our transition team into the search committee. We have made that proposal to our board, and our board has approved the transition team to become the search committee with the addition of two of our board members. John Severin and Dean Johnson will also be on the search committee. And so we hope to begin that process within the next week or two, and are looking forward to report back to you as we progress. So I'm looking forward. It's a little bit weird to be standing up here and saying, replace me. Replace me. Bring somebody else who will do a far better job than I could do. Not for this time, but for the long run. Someone who will come into this church that God has appointed that will allow this church to thrive and to flourish, not only as a community of believers, but as a church working in our community toward the mission or the commission that Jesus has given us to do. So looking forward to that. As we begin this morning, I want to continue from last Sunday, and I want to invite someone to read Philippians chapter 3, verses 7 to 11. So as you think about that, I'm just going to open up in prayer. Father, as we come this morning, you have given us the vision that you have for us, and that is for us to know you. Your whole ministry to us from the very beginning, since Adam and Eve, was to reveal yourself to us, for us to reach out to you and to cling to you and to draw close to you. And so, Father, we pray that we would understand how that is possible this morning. So we ask that you would show us in Jesus' name. Amen. So I want to begin with Philippians chapter 3, verses 7 to 11. And I'd love for someone to be able to read that passage for us, if you could, please. Just lift your hand and I'll get you the mic and you can. Thank you, Dallas.
Philippians 3, verses 7. But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ. The righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead.
Twice in this passage we find that Paul uses the word know, to know Christ. He says in verse 10, I want to know Christ. Now here we have an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm sure that he had this wonderful relationship, but still, Paul says, I want to know. There's no end. There's no end to knowing who Jesus is. In John chapter 17, verse 3, this is Jesus' prayer. Jesus says this. He says, now this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent, that they may know you. That was Jesus' prayer, that we would know God. Sometimes we think the answer to some of the deep questions are very simple, and it's not always quite that simple. Some years ago, I was pondering this question of knowing God, and I was discussing it with some of our church leaders. And one of our leaders came up with the answer. He says, "You want to know God? Just read the Bible. Just read the Bible. It's all in there." And that's a very simple statement to say, but it's very hard to define, isn't it? If you're going to know God, you've got to go more than just say, take the whole. You've got to dig in a lot deeper than that. Because reading the Bible is indeed very insightful. Reading the Bible allows us to have understanding of God's vision, but it's not just as simple as reading the Bible. Last week, we considered God's vision for his church, revealing that the first part of that revelation is to know God, to know him, to really know him. Jesus' life and his ministry surrounded around that vision of us knowing God. His whole reason for coming, yes, was multi-purposed, but part of that reason was for us to have that opportunity to really know who God is. In Jesus' prayer with the Father, he says, "This is eternal life, that they may know you." Again, we understand that part of Jesus' mission was for us to really understand who God is and to know him. And I think for every truly born-again believer, there is something inside of us that says, how can I know God more? How many of us are satisfied with the relationship we have with God? Don't want to go any deeper. We know as much as we want to know about God, as far as we want to go with him. No, I'm sure that all of us say, you know what? Yes, I know Jesus to this extent. I know God to this extent, but I want to go deeper. I want to know God more intimately. I want to go further with God. And we find that certainly the Christian faith holds to some very dear and core doctrines. And knowing God is not merely an intellectual understanding. It's not primarily following moral codes and doing good deeds. It's not dependent on these emotional or charismatic or spiritual experiences. It's not specified by us folding our hands or kneeling in prayer. Those are all elements that take us to that place. But we can't depend on one or the other to take us to the place where we can know God as fully as possible. At the heart of what it means to know God is that of an ongoing relationship. An ongoing relationship through the Lord Jesus Christ. And in order to do that, we depend. We depend on Scripture. We depend on understanding Scripture. We depend on the actions that take place in our lives. We depend on those experiences that we have. We depend upon prayer. And we depend upon the work of the Holy Spirit. When it comes to relationships, I believe that you already know that personal relationships are not static. Personal relationships are not fixed. Personal relationships are always in constant change. They're in development. There is progress. Sometimes there is regress as well. But generally, we want to progress in our relationships. Relationships are active and they are interactive. And if you are married or if you have been married at some point or another, then you understand this completely. You understand what it means to have that relationship, to for that relationship not to be static, but active and interactive and developing. And so also is this vision that God has for us, individually and as a church. It is an interactive relationship, an ongoing relationship, a growing relationship, a struggling relationship. It comes with all kinds of emotions. It comes with learning. It comes with understanding. It permeates every part of our being. And so naturally, we tend to ask, I would say, probably three questions. First of all, how can I know God? How can I know God? Then how can I draw closer to Him? I want to know God, but then knowing God to a certain extent isn't enough. I want to know Him more. I want to draw closer to Him. How can I know Him more deeply? How can I go more intimately with the Lord Jesus Christ? And the answer, the key to that answer is Jesus. Jesus is the way and the light. Jesus is the way and the light. Without Jesus, the answer to this question would be impossible. Jesus proclaims in John chapter 14, verses 6 and 7, he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And then I like these words because Jesus says, if you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. It is Jesus that gives us the picture of the Father. Jesus prays in our passage we mentioned earlier that they may know you. Eternal life is a personal, intimate relationship with God, with the Father, with the Son, and with the Holy Spirit. It is this interactive relationship. Eternal life and knowing God is not like a vaccination. You don't get inoculated and then you're good for the rest of your life. It doesn't happen that way. You don't just accept the Lord and then you're protected forever and ever and you go to heaven. Knowing God is a connection. Knowing God is a union. Knowing God is having this life source come from Him. It is this interactive relationship that you have with Him. John chapter 1, verse 4, Jesus says, or John chapter 1, verse 4 says, in Him, that is Jesus, was life, and that life was the light of men. Jesus, again, is the key. When Jesus comes into your life through faith, it is now Jesus that sheds light on who God is. It is through Jesus that we understand, so that we are able to see Him, and so that we are able to grow more and more, knowing Him better. Trying to look for some examples of how that might relate to us in a practical way, I'm thinking of driving through snowstorms. And if you are in the prairies, you've driven, I'm sure, through snowstorms. But or through fog, and that fog is very popular in BC as well. But if you're coming down the mountain to trail, but if you're driving through the fog, and the fog is really thick, you know, the first thing you do is you hammer on the brakes and you slow right down, because you can't see whether there's a vehicle in front of you. And if you're a little older and you remember when vehicles didn't have their lights on all the time, you understand. I know in the last 20 or 30 years, all the vehicles have their lights on all the time. But before that, when you were in the fog, you were driving, you were at a crawl, because you couldn't see the vehicle. But if a vehicle had its lights on, you could begin to see that vehicle coming at a distance. And then you confidently moved ahead. You confidently drove in your lane because you could see the vehicle on the other side. You could see where you were going. It's similar with the Lord Jesus Christ. Before the Lord Jesus Christ came into this world, it was like going through this fog. But when Jesus came, he shed light, and we see God in another way. And we confidently move forward. Faith becomes active. Faith becomes active when we see Jesus. The personal reality of Jesus in our life is that we now can relate to God. We can relate to him in a way that we begin to grow. We begin to understand, and we come to know God more and more. We begin to develop not just knowledge of God, but we begin to develop a friendship with God. That friendship comes through Jesus. Jesus prays in John chapter 17, verses 25 and 26. He prays this. He says, "Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you. And they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love that you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them." Jesus says, "I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known." Jesus' ministry on earth hasn't just ended. That ministry to make God known is still active today. Knowing God is a personal relationship with the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, as I have mentioned. But we sometimes may ask, well, how does it work? How does it work? Well, Jesus is the life and the light. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 27, here Jesus says, "No one knows the Son except the Father. No one knows the Son except the Father. And no one knows the Father except the Son. And to those whom the Son chooses to reveal him." In other words, without Jesus, it's not even possible to really know God. It might have been in the Old Testament because God revealed himself through his Spirit. But today, the revelation of God is given to us through Jesus. No one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Irenaeus, an early church theologian, is quoted saying this: "No one can know the Father apart from his Son." He says, "The Son fulfills the Father's good pleasure. The Son is sent and he comes. The Father is beyond sight and comprehension, but he is known by his word, that is the Lord Jesus Christ, who shows us him who surpasses all telling. The Son reveals the Father by his revelation of himself." And I think this takes us back to Jesus when he was 12 years old and he was meeting with the teachers of the law. And they were astounded. They were astounded by Jesus' understanding. And I think if we allow ourselves the imagination, we might be taken away by the words of Wendy Bagwell's song, "On My Mother's Side." Anybody recognize that song, "On My Mother's Side"? Let me just share the chorus of that song. And it goes like this: "What is your name?" And it's referring to Jesus. "What is your name? On my mother's side, my name is Jesus. On my father's side, Emmanuel." And we understand what Emmanuel is, right? God with us. "How old are you, son? On my mother's side, I'm just 12 years. On my father's side, I've always been. And where were you born? On my mother's side, I was born in Jerusalem. On my father's side, the New Jerusalem. What are your plans, son? On my mother's side, I will be crucified. On my father's side, in 3 days, I will rise. I will rise and sit at my father's side. And I think that gives us this wonderful picture of Jesus, who is both God and human. Now I lost my place. Here we are. So we come to this place of really understanding that to know Jesus is to know the Father. To know Jesus is to know the Father. In John chapter 8, verse 58, Jesus says, "I tell you the truth, before Abraham was, I am." Before Abraham was, I am. The I am in the Hebrew is a statement proclaiming, I exist from everlasting to everlasting. And every Jewish person in Israel at that time would have understood this expression. In Exodus and in Isaiah, God identifies himself as I am. I am. I exist from everlasting to everlasting. Jesus' union with the Father is an identity that comes from eternity to eternity. There's an identity there from eternity to eternity. From my father's side, Emmanuel. From my mother's side, human. And just like you and I, Jesus had to start at zero. He was born as a little baby in Bethlehem. And Scripture tells us in Luke chapter 2, verse 52, Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men. We understand that Jesus grew up just like every other human being. Jesus had to learn to walk. Jesus had to learn to talk. He had to learn to read. He had to learn his trade. He even had to learn his relationship with the Father. He needed to learn. He needed to grow. Jesus, in that process, was tested. He was taught. He was moved. He was directed by the Holy Spirit. In Hebrews chapter 5, verse 8, Scripture says, although he was a son, he learned obedience from what he suffered. Jesus didn't sin, but he went through life process and suffered, learning along the way. Jesus experienced the fullness of human life. However, the eternal divine spirit of Jesus was never, ever disconnected from the Father. In his humanity, in his heart, he had to learn relationship, his relationship with the Father. And we see that relationship in the actions of Jesus. In John chapter 5, verse 19, Jesus says, I tell you the truth, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can only do what he sees his Father doing, because whatever his Father does, the Son also does. Jesus took his full direction from his Father. John chapter 10, verse 15, just as the Father knows me, I know the Father. And John chapter 10, verse 30, I and the Father are one. There is this close connection between the Father and the Son, between Jesus and God the Father. This isn't possible without this intimate, close relationship. It's just not possible. No relationship such as this is possible without this deep sense of love and connection, which Jesus had with the Father. And so we find that the Father and the Son love each other. The Father and the Son love each other. John chapter 3, verse 35, the Father says, the Father loves the Son and has placed everything in his hands. Matthew chapter 3, verse 13, the Father proclaims, this is my Son whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Mark chapter 9, verse 7, the Father says, "This is my son, whom I love." And then he adds these words, "Listen to him. Listen to him." In response, Jesus says in John chapter 14, verse 31, "I love the Father, and I do exactly what my Father has commanded me." Jesus possessed in his humanity every human free will. But in that free will, when he was tempted, Jesus chose the Father over himself. When we look at Jesus' life, the love for his Father chose obedience instead of disobedience. Out of love for the Father, Jesus chose faithfulness instead of unfaithfulness. Out of love for the Father, Jesus chose the cross. He chose the cross instead of affirming the well-founded sin that is found in our lives. There's a point to the love of the Father and the Son. Out of love for the Father, Jesus came into this world. He came into this world to show us the Father, to show us the Father so that we would know him, so that we would know God. And when we look at it all, we find that love is the foundation of this relationship. And the relationship, our relationship is the foundation to knowing God. In John chapter 14, verse 7, Jesus says, "If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Jesus builds this relationship, this bond with his disciples. They saw Jesus, they lived with Jesus, they loved Jesus, and they got to know Jesus. And Jesus is telling them, "If you know me, you know the Father." The Son is the radiance of God's glory. That's what Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3 says. The Son is the radiance of God's glory, the exact representation of his being. Jesus never says, "I am the Father." But that if we know him, he says, we also know the Father. And to help us to know Jesus, to help us to know the Father, Jesus has left or has called, through the authority of the Father, the Holy Spirit to come down into this world to dwell with us. It's not that God left us. Jesus left, but he gave us the Holy Spirit in his place to take the place of Jesus, not for the salvation of our souls, but so that we are enabled and empowered not only to know who God is, but to able to have that relationship with him and to be used by the Lord for his glory. Love and relationship grow together, come together, work together to know God. And so the real question for us is, do we love God? I believe that if you truly love God, it will take you to that place of knowing him. If you don't love God, if you're going through the motions, if your idea is, "I just want to go to heaven, I don't want to go to hell, I just want to know the Lord enough so that I can get on that revelation bus and make it into heaven," I don't think that you will really get to know God. But when you come to a place of loving God, it will drive you into this close, intimate relationship with God, and you will know him. Sometimes the question of do you love God isn't a yes or a no question. It's an action question. If you remember Jesus asked Peter in John chapter 21, verses 15 to 17. Jesus says, Simon, son of John, do you truly love me more than these? Yes, Lord, Peter said, you know I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you truly love me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know I love you. Jesus said, take care of my sheep. The third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? The scripture says Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him a third time, do you love me? And he said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my sheep. Feed my sheep. At the end of the conversation, Jesus says these words, follow me. Follow me. Following Jesus, no one can do anything but know him. If you follow Jesus, you will know him. You will truly, truly know him. And it will take you into action. And we're going to cover that next week on the second part of that question of the vision that God has for his church. Father, we thank you and praise you that you have given us the Lord Jesus Christ. We have seen that vision of us knowing you. As I imagine Adam and Eve had that great and wonderful relationship with you, you have made that again possible through the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, certainly I realize, Lord, that we will not walk sinless lives. Even Adam and Eve fell. But Lord, we have you, Jesus, who stands as our advocate, who stands in our place, who stands in the gap. And you reveal the Father to us. And so we thank you for that wonderful privilege. As we look at your vision of knowing you, we also want to look what else you have for us. We look forward to that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Carl, for your message and encouragement to know Jesus and to follow him. Please rise as we sing our closing song.
Could not earn all surpass.
everlasting gift of righteousness, knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness, and I love you, Lord. Oh, to know the power of your risen life, and to know you in your suffering, to become like you in your death, my Lord, so with you to live and never die. Knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness, and I love you, Lord. Knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness, and I love you, Lord.
And now, may you know this love of Christ that surpasses, so that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Amen.